Guidelines and the form of scriptures and spiritual lineage should take the guardianship. And you know that there is rise and fall, dawn and dusk, everything is very common, waxing and waning of moon like that we are seeing. Whenever there is what Krishna has stated, dharmasya janihi abhyutaram adharmasya. So periodically, every century or millennia, each and every developing religion or structure or philosophy or way of life that will meet some sort of deterioration. At the time of its decline, there will be a mass consciousness or collective consciousness or a mega consciousness. Collective consciousness arises from a group of people thinking alike and working for a common purpose. And mass consciousness at the time of revolution, like the French Revolution, the Indian freedom struggle, it comes from mass. Then a mega renaissance, it comes from a supernatural delegation by which a Mahapurusha, a great personality, he descends to reinstall the status and glory of this thing. So it happens everywhere. So we must understand that the decline of any culture, as well as the revival, intrusion, fusion, dilution, these things are common in social expansion. And it is our duty, just as we know that we will get dust and dirt while in travel, we have to take bath. Just as we are taking bath and cleaning ourselves, a cleansing process for our religion, culture and philosophy, routinely, with greater effort and concentration on special occasions, at the time of crisis, a mass integral protest and supportive mechanism of reactivating the spiritual glory, these things are very essential. So, this declination, this situation of the despicable condition that we are seeing for our culture, that we have to correlate with the past history as well as rise and fall of other civilizations, and we have to make a probable action plan by which we have to reinstall it. So now, declination is natural, and our duty is to reinstall the glory because it is the model. It will decline and we have to reinstall. So now we are in the phase of resurrection or reinstallation of glory of our whole land by means of knowing it, practicing it by ourselves, inculcating and inspiring others, and making a conglomeration of like-minded people, and by means of prayer and worship, work and protest, demand of our rights and settlement of our proper duties, we have to make a proper way of doing like that. At least we should start speaking about that. Somebody asked, what is the use of speaking? It has not been so in Shastras. Whenever you speak good things, naturally it ignites some people. For example, you know that in the welding shop, you might have seen hundreds of sparks coming out of a welding machine. But everything becomes extinguished. A small spark with your gas cylinder and stove, if it is well connected, that does not become an extinguished spark, but a distinguished spark, because it is connected with a combustible material known as gas, and also affixed with that of a protective mechanism or apparatus known as a stove, which is meant for cooking or heating something else. So each and every spark should be connected with a combustible and reacting force, reflecting surface, which should be affixed to a protective apparatus, whereby it can reach the society and bring the transformation which we desire. So this is the explanation for civilization. Generally, somebody asks, are we civilized now? Were we civilized before? What is the level of our civilization? What is the real stage? Then I just answered, it cannot be considered like that. Wherever we consider that we are in advancement, that is not a compensation, that is not a relevant and righteous compensation to what we have lost. We have lost a lot of things, no doubt we have gained few things, but whatever we have gained is not a relevant compensation, righteous compensation for what we have lost. So we have gained in some other way which is aimless and which is having no control or proper directive mechanism, and whatever we have lost is irretrievable and easily not compensatable by means of what we call as advancement or development. That's what I mentioned. So here the present position is in such a manner that we have to concentrate upon so many things irrespective of, in spite of the various so-called climate technological advancements that we now boast that we have achieved. And what is civilization, somebody asked? What is the difference between our civilization and other civilizations? And what is the parameter for a civilization? Perfect civilization, what we call a sublime status of civilization, how we can measure it? Three things have to be understood in civilization. If person understands three things, then he becomes well civilized. What is behind him, what is beyond him, and what is around him? If these things are understood, that is not a civilization. Understanding things behind everything is known as science. Understanding things around him is known as society and environment. Understanding everything beyond him is known as understanding of God. These three things are known as the hallmarks or the parameters of civilization. Understanding the fundamentals of everything, which is known as the foundation of science also, is ontology. And understanding everything, living being, subhuman species, the physical and biological and environmental factors, understanding everything is known as ecology. And understanding the binding factor, which by its connective will has created everything, sustained everything, absorbs everything, and manipulates everything by its own power and will out of infinite mercy, only for the sole cause of upliftment of mankind towards the pathway of knowledge, realization, and emancipation. So it is known as ecology, ontology, and theology. So a person becomes fully civilized when he understands and reacts. That's what I told. Civilization has two phases. The first phase is to know how to use everything for him. The second phase of civilization, real advanced civilization, is how to be useful to those things which are around him. So it prevents a person from exploitation. It prevents a person from special domination or special supremacy. It prevents the person from going against nature. So how to be useful to the nature which has bestowed its choices to beneficial showers on him, it is known as real civilization. And there are two models of civilization. One is known as origination model and second is known as advancement research model. What is origination model? How civilization originated? Our system of philosophy has a very unique system of understanding about civilization. It is known as born mature model. It deals with the rishis. So what it states is, civilization is not gradual. It is not by a process which undergoes for several millennium of years, by which the person gradually understands about something which is at the last. The Veda says that at the time of creation itself, along with the uncivilized creatures and subhuman species and various varieties of human beings, especially delegated people for the installation of Jnana Parampara, for the installation of lineage of wisdom, they have appeared by a special sankalpa. Visishta sankalpera jayante maharshayaha. Everybody like samanyas, what we call normal human beings, who were by means of a process they developed. Maharishis were also created by God simultaneously with full maturity. The maturity to control themselves and go for a deeper meditation for understanding the perfections and precisions of the world. So they are born mature. There are three models in this. One is known as base model theory, second is simultaneous emergence theory, and the third theory is culmination theory. Base theory says that at first only the spiritual realization came. Only from the spiritual realization, creation of the world, development of what we call civilization, what we read about civilization is understanding fire, then understanding about clothing, understanding how to eat cooked food, and domestication of animals, agriculture. These things we consider to be the marks of civilization. But the base theory is that civilization started with a primogenitor and a group of primogenitors who are known as rishis or brahmas or somebody else. Those people who are born mature, they installed the process of creation. So civilization only created the world, and from world there is also one more process of simultaneous emergence which cannot refute the rishis tradition who are born mature. Second thing I have already told, simultaneous emergence. When human beings, when they went for filling their belly, simultaneously, maybe a day after or before, simultaneously, gradually, this also started the quest for brain and the quest for the craving for the soul. So everything started simultaneously, they emerged with different people or in different places. Culmination theory states that your person starts from Annamaya Kosha, that is to take care of his own self, then gradually develop his own shelter, his family, his nearby or proximate society, then a broader society, then dealing with the universal spirit. So this says about the universal theory or the theory of culmination by which a person understands the so-called civilization which I mentioned at the end. Whereas we believe that civilization is ever existing. The manifestation of civilization to several places, to several persons, in several grades may be different, but it is ever existing as per our shastras. So we have been trained by, we have been ruled by, we have been initiated by a well mature complete structure model of Maharishis who were conservative in their status, who are not just by observation or by experimentation verification, cross verification, referential status, or environmental study. These things are not by those people. Whatever we have observed by observation, they have done by closing their eyes. We require an additional tool for our eyes to see and verify something. They closed even the basic tool, eye, and they have looked upon the things. We have to move here and there for gaining something. They have sat on a tree, underneath a tree, on a fire, just in one leg, in various postures. They just maintained uniformity and internal harmony by which they could see everything reflected inside in inertia without doing anything. So this is the greatness of our tradition. So we believe in the Maharishi tradition, whereas the other civilization, it is simultaneous emergence and it may be even culmination type of rule. And advancements, what we are seeing, everybody is saying that we are advanced. How we are advanced? Is it absolute advancement, or abundant advancement, or apparent advancement? Absolute advancement means that we must be very happy. Abundant means we must be having more happiness and more comfort. Whatever we are seeing is apparent advancement, in which the inner sense is burning and we are very much comfortable with an outer ornament. So whatever we are seeing is apparent advancement. So what we want to bring is, Shastras bring three major benefits. Salvation as the ultimate benefit, solution to problems, it is the second benefit, and solidarity to face the problems is the third benefit. So it gives you comfort to face the problems, as well as to solve the problems, as well as to get out of the hold of the problems themselves by a process known as eternity, in which you go to salvation. These things are assured in our Shastra. So the advancement now available is only apparent advancement. So this clearly shows that we are having a role in teaching and guiding others, before which we must be well taught and well guided by our own people here, either in the form of treatises, or in the form of tutors, or in the form of transcendental authorities who are invisible going to guide us. First, we must be well trained and guided before facing others and before comforting other people. So, there are three types of people according to Shastras who will come for the renaissance of civilization. One is known as Uddharaka, second is Vyavasthapaka, third person is Sthapaka. A person who is born at the time of the inceptive stage of the universe to inculcate the systems of three lines of philosophy, they are known as Uddharakas. Great people, or even divine incarnations, are known as Uddharakas. And persons who are in the continuous lineage to organize things through works, by teachings, by comfortable methodologies of tuition, and by the divine embrace. We used to say Dikshana, Sparisha, Bodhana, Smarana, Kripa. By various these tools of a touch, by thought, by transmission, by transfiguration, by just showering the mercy upon the person, they were able to tutor those people for getting that knowledge. They are known as Vyavasthapakas. And whenever this Vyavasthapaka parampara, this lineage is going in declination, at that time, for its reinstallation, lot of people, they are going to come, they are known as Samsthapakas. So we had lot of Uddharakas now, we cannot become Uddharaka. Lot of people, they are well established. We have lot of Vyavasthapakas. Now what we want is a Samsthapaka. That is why any organization is known as Sthapana, Samstha, or Samsthapana. Because the duty is to reinstall the glory, to establish it in Sthapana. Because the duty is to reinstall the glory, to establish it in its original form, unalloyed form, in a safeguarded, fortified manner. That is what we call Samsthapana, Samsthapaka. So we need the rule of Samsthapakas now. That is the present era. And how the civilization, it develops, and how we are going to do that? Civilization has two extensions. One is culture, and second is heritage. Civilization is innate maturity of status, and when it extends into behavioral manifestation, in forms of both intellectual and psychological dimensions, it becomes culture. When it is preserved over time, where it can adapt all circumstances, and remain unalloyed and pure, where it can dominate any circumstances, any person, it can face any hurdles and withstand, that is known as heritage. So there are two extensions for civilization. Civilization can manifest, whatever the psychological manifestations of the civilization in the form of culture, brotherhood, magnanimity, forgiving other people, upliftment of the humanity, empathy and sympathy towards the fellow beings, these are all the psycho-behavioral extensions. What are the epistemological extensions or manifestations? Understanding about everything. Ontology, understanding about the base. Teleology, understanding about the purpose of life. Epistemology, understanding the origination of knowledge. Theology, understanding the nature of God. Eschatology, understanding the life after death and eternity. metaphysics, understanding indriyatita anubhuti, that which is beyond the purview of senses. Thaumatology, understanding about the paranormal senses. Aretology, understanding about the divine principles. Agathology, understanding of the philosophy of the sin and virtue. So these things are the intellectual manifestations. Apart from which, there are also these things are known as subtle intellectual manifestations. There are also tangible manifestations in the form of navigation, aeronautical engineering, construction engineering, textiles and designing, ornamental studies. So we have a lot of such things. Those civilizations are always mentioned and studied and considered by people as, yes, pottery was there, ornamental things were there, script was there, language was there. These things are not just mere measures of civilization. These things come under the tangible intellectual manifestations of culture. So there are innumerable things like this. So apart from which these tangible and subtle intellectual and psychological manifestations, we come to heritage. Heritage, I already told, it is a continuous flow. And it creates an impact, and nobody can create an impact inside it. That type of sturdity in our culture is known as heritage, and we are calling it by the name of heritage, Indian heritage if you call, then there is a meaning inside it. And there are two things which I want to say here. Number one, that which is subjected to continuous growth and modification, that which is immutable. Whatever we see in the world that is overruled by a second model, even in electronics you know that. Whatever any productivity that comes in the form of any product or any apparatus or any other design that is overruled by a similar design or a salient model or some more advanced and upgraded systems, you are seeing that. But this type of thing, what we call nitya, niravadya, nirakshata, nishkalanga, satya, all of these words, sanatan, all of these words, they denote that it is immutable and it is eternal. It cannot be overruled by anything, it is irreplaceable. And there is nothing equal to that. It is nissamabhyadhika. It has no equivalence or excellence. So that is the greatness of our status. So we have some model. Why we are talking about our civilization? We have crossed the civilization over thousands of years. Still we are talking about that because of the reason that, number one, that is eternal and that is very much required now emergently. So because of two reasons. One is of eternity, second is of emergence. That is the only solution for the problems that we face with us, with others, and others face with us. So all the global predicament of systems or structures, they have only one solution, and the solution is to repatriate ourselves to practically implementing the civilization inside our veins, not by an epidemic ointment or coverage, practically making it intravenous. So having a pragmatic approach towards our civilization to rebring the power of the glory of our tradition is the work that we are going to do now. And for that, there are a lot of hindrances. We have to understand the problem analysis or failure investigation as well as the success studies. We have to understand the problems in society. Number one, what we have now is present scenario. We have no power for deeper transformations. There is no possibility for deeper transformation because of the reason that we have more belief than power. Power is different from belief. A person having the power of money can achieve things with money. The person just believes in money cannot achieve it. No doubt belief is the threshold for everything. You must believe God, you must practice it in the form of worship, you must accomplish your worship, then it becomes a power. Power creates your ability to do things and also to authorize people to do things. Now most of the people who are going to temples, they are just astikas, having a belief, taking a divine shelter for their problems or justification of their mistakes or evasion from the sins committed knowingly or unknowingly. So such type of people basically blended with just belief cannot be powerful receptacles as well as producers who are required for renaissance of this glory. What are the powers? How we can accumulate that power? Shastra says it is panchanga. One is ritual, by performing the kratus we can do that. And number two, by meditation, by dhyana we can do that. Upasana, by selecting a deity and by chanting mantra several times, we can do that. And Nididhyasana, by understanding something from the Upanishads and following the Vedic view of deeper meditation, that is entirely different. Even though that is also a type of meditation, that is entirely different. Worshipping Brahman is known as Nididhyasana. And taking a deity and chanting the mantras and following the system of worship is known as Upasana, which is contemplation. And the third type of thing is Dhyana. Just continue to think about the structure of abstract. So that is good to come. So these rituals, these various modes of worship, practicing austerity. austerity in food, austerity in restraint of senses, you have to follow a lot of things like that. So this is the power mechanism inside our religion. So if you are not following these rituals, not having any upasana, not having any dhyana or anything else, not having achara and anushtana, where is the possibility of getting that power? If you are not having the power, what is the difference between Satyam Veda that is given in our Vedas and the same thing given in the ethical treatises and other religious treatises? We have to get the power to speak the truth. We have to get the power to make others also to speak the truth. We have the power to face the problems while we are speaking the truth. We have to see that we sustain in speaking the truth. To that we have to gain some power. The power is gained only by these practices. So the practices, if they are not there, then there is no use for them. Moreover, now the society is having one more problem. That is what we call religio-industrial complex. Anything starting from a parrot astrology, vastu, everything, there are innumerable bindings in the religion. People are very much confused which is a real religion, which is having the real Vedic affinity or loyalty, and which is something intruded, which is reliable, which is accountable. So there is a lot of confusion because there is no check-up mechanism. So innumerable things, innumerable worships which are not regularized, and various things in the name of the same religion is there. It is known as religio-industrial multi-level complex. So lot of people they are inside, and they don't have any authentic membership, they don't have any touch with the heritage, they don't have anything to do with the knowledge of our system, but still as a beneficiary they are getting into different things, and they are considering the same system to be Purna, that is known as Brahma. Brahma is a confused state by a person having a part of a system where he is mistaking that part of the system to be the complete system, thereby he is denying the opportunity to access the real value of the system and to be a proper supporter for the religion or the system and its development. That is the problem with the religio-industrial multi-level complex. And moreover, we are having a lot of people, but those people, they are not vivifiers. We used to define these people, so-called religious people, into three stages. The first person is a ground supporter. Those who are telling Srimad Ramayana, Bhagavata, either it may be a cine play or it may be a dramatic play or it may be even a katha kalakshepa, a lecture or discourse. Those people, they are giving you a ground for your belief. They are known as blind ground producers or providers. The second level of people, they structure and shape you. Those people, they deal with Upanishad, those people, they give explanations about various intricacies of life. What is the greatness of one philosophy? There are three greatnesses. One, it is universally applicable. Number two, it is eternally, it is relevant. Number three, it can answer any question. That which is having three powers. One is the power of cultivation. Second is the power of clarification. Third is the power of conviction, that which can cultivate divinity inside you and clarify all the doubts that are against the installation of divinity, and that which can bring you real, genuine, unfading conviction inside your mind. That is known as knowledge. So that type of knowledge can be provided by these people, those who are structuring and shaping you. But what we want is a vivifier. Vivifier is a strong spiritual spirit. A very great Mahapurusha, what we call Rishis. So such people, vivifiers, they only can do things. That's what we used to also call, there is a skeleton, there is a stuff inside, there is a skin, and there is a spirit. Then only it can become a perfect organism. Whatever we speak in this mic, or before we stuffed with their own trials, association with good people and learned personalities, it could be stuffed. Then it must be well packed with your determination. That is Vairagya, Sankalpa, Chitta. So it must be skinned. Then God or a godly, godlike, God-sent person should vivify and activate it with spirit. Now we are in only skeleton model. It should be stuffed, skinned and spirited in our various things. So that type of availability is very much uncommon in the society. Very much less in the society. Unless we make that, there is no possibility for that. Second thing is, there is no common minimal program between various spiritual groups. Lot of spiritual groups are there, they are having their own acharya, they are having their own war, worship and other things, and they are very much attributed towards their acharyas, towards their lineage inseparably. Irrespective of their status, there are innumerable people like that, and they are having thousands of millions of followers. But when there is a crisis for the religion commonly, when there is a need for support, there is no common minimal program effectively done. That is the second major problem which we are facing now. So unless we make that common minimal program between, already I am having thousands of followers and he will be having hundreds of followers. When there is a common program, these 1,100 people, they are not delegated for a common purpose to show a federal strength in the society. If we show a strength in the society, that will imbibe other people also who will be inspired. That will create a democratic threat in the society, whereby our things will be heard and there will be a proper response from government. So for getting everything sanctioned from the public, from government and agencies, there must be a combined union of various people assembling for a common purpose. That type of common minimal programming, we should pray, because we cannot meet great people and bell them. We can just pray that there can be a common minimal program. And the third problem that we are facing with the society is, apart from these various other entanglements, whatever we are having in the form of people, now I am speaking, he is speaking, lot of people are speaking, we are speaking about rishis. Then there arises a question. A person similarly in the question and session, he asks, are we a rishi? Have you seen a rishi? Are you suitable to be a communicator or adapter of a rishi? He asks the question. We don't know. We are talking about a rishi model. If you are talking about a rishi model, either we must be a rishi, or we must have the major qualities of the rishi, or we must have at least the receptivity to be an adaptator or a communicator with a rishi. So we must be having arshatva, arsha sambandha, or arshanugraha. We can develop arshanugraha by means of practicing the inculcations and injections of our ancestors. We can create arshanugraha patra muktatva, in which we can get the blessings of rishi. And whatever we are seeing now, I have heard lot of lectures in which people say that the rishis, they just, they moved in ether, they went inside the ocean. Okay, now can we use their techniques? They have worshipped God and they have contemplated for millions of years to get the power. And where is the time? Who is ready to, for even 2 or 3 years of study, the people are not interested. They want crash courses. Within 10 days, they want to learn how to master cosmic spirit in Reiki. So that people, will they be ready? Even if they are ready, the longevity is not ready, they cannot work for that. So, now whatever we are seeing as technological development is nothing but a substitution for our inherent laws. That's why the Shastra say, it is a substitution for our inherent laws. For example, all the people before few millennia, they were capable of having the Vedas in their memory. They did not have any book or printed format. And even palm-leaf scripts were not used in most of the parshalas. Now the print industry is not only development of a technology, but also it is a compensation which substitutes the inherent loss of conscient memory, capable memory which the people have. We have lost the memory and we are having this. Likewise, calculator, computer, each and everything is not only in the modern view, if you see that it is a technological advancement. And in our view, if you see that it is a substitution for our inherent loss. We had those things. Without the intervention of any mechanism, we were capable of doing it with our own will, for which we require a machine. We require a mechanical intervention. That's what I told, even after 10 or 20 years, if you ask somebody their names, they will just ask us to wait for a minute, they will see the computer and they will repeat. They will reply. Like that, the person's cognitive skill has been eroded and it has been substituted by a lot of mechanisms which is not a development at all. So what is the model of adoption of civilization? Can we completely adopt a civilization which was there before 2000 years? Is it a complete adoption or essential adoption or a tailored or suitable mode of adoption? We cannot have complete adoption, you know that. We are not in that environment, we have crossed a long way. Second thing is suitable model, which we are going to discuss now. Third, there is a wrong philosophy that is being propagated in the society. That is what we call essential adoption. What is essential adoption? You forget all the mantras, tantra, puja, vidhana, everything. You just follow truth, non-violence, purity, all of these things. This is very impossible. Because there are a lot of problems in essential absorption. Because that is a philosophy known as suction. What is suction? If you follow the dress code of a person, of a system, it will lead you to follow the system at all. Then it leads you to go to the language. It makes you to go into the behaviors. It makes you to go into the lifestyle and it aims in the character. So according to Shastras, if you make a lifestyle by means of a cloth, that is a dress style or something, then actually that leads to the language, the behaviors, then the mind setup, and it aims with the character. That's why the great people, they were very much firm with the acharas and practices. According to our heritage, having a dress code, having the tilak, having something which represents our culture, that is a very strong reminder and facilitator of our thoughts to be in a proper orbit and axis. Because even though if something is followed externally, that may pave a way to go into that mind setup, language, behaviors and characters. This thing is unavoidable. And what do you mean by character here? What do you mean by character here? Character is defined as the levels of rigidity, liberty, tolerance, and flexibility. How far you can be flexible, where you can be flexible, where you are rigid, how far you are tolerant, and what is the status of your liberty. So this distends a person's character. Some people, you know, that they are tolerant for even greatest things, even greatest aberrations, they are tolerant in some systems. Even for a smallest thing, it is minded with more care. In some systems, it is very natural. So this is what we call character. So in this character, we have to be very much careful in distilling all of these things in both ethics, visible ethics and subtle ethics. What is subtle ethics? It deals with celibacy and chastity, respect and bondage, total renunciation and charity or benevolence. These things are subtle ethics. You share everything with all of the people, that is benevolence. If you give it to all, that is known as benevolence. If you throw them away, that is known as renunciation. And moreover, there is a system of respect. One, there was a lecture in which we addressed whatever we are having, like getting up, folding the hands, then covering your mouth and prostration, everything that we practice in a system of respect, it is a spontaneous emergence in a mature soul. And it is not created by compulsion or by any other rule and regulation. That which is spontaneous has been experienced by people. So whatever we give to elders, whatever we give to scholars, that is the respect system here, and family bondage. So bondage and respect or reverence, detachment and benevolence, as well as celibacy and chastity, these things are known as subtle ethics. These subtle ethics are to be understood only from our system, wherein most of the people, their tolerance and liberty levels are entirely different. So here only the character differs from the West to East. If you follow in the dress code, then immediately it penetrates with the character at all. Then it will create a very big confusion in the society. And Shastra has also given some exemptions. Wearing the dress, there are also two people. Those who are in orthodoxy and hypocrisy. Those who are in the structure, those who are in the style of the religion, so-called heritage. There are a lot of hypocritic personalities and orthodox personalities who are no longer used to the society. And even in a different suit, there are people whose inner suit is very much attuned to our heritage. The outer suit may be different. These things are just exceptional models, not exemplary models. So we have to take an event suit. Whenever we go to temple, whenever we are before elders, we have to put our own structure and style. We must be with our representation of our own heritage, which is a good reminder, facilitator and booster of our spirit of pride and the spirit of our commitment towards reinstallation of the glory of our culture. So we have to follow all of these things. So what is the greatness of India in that, you know, that there are three systems of life. They are known as instinctive based elements. One is hedonism. Life is for just enjoying, so enjoy the life. And second thing is intrinsic or instinctive justification. We are having instinct, so we are doing that. Why God has created that? It is a type of justification like that. And the third thing is abstemious grant. Nothing is a fault or nothing is to be prohibited if they are done abstemiously, to a limit. To be prohibited if they are done abstemiously, to a limit, to drink, that is a small bit, or to eat beef, just a small piece. So something which is abstemious is not going to be pernicious. So there is abstemious grant philosophy, there is hedonistic philosophy, there is instinctive justification philosophy. Elephants are brushing the teeth, then why God has created fishes. So innumerable this type of justification of instincts and various things are there amongst the people. And there is extreme rigidity in one side, like Middle East philosophy, was extreme rigidity. Extreme liberty in the other side. So we have a rational approach. That's why I addressed in one theism conference, the conference of theology. I told that we are the only country where there is choice, where there is chance, where there is rule for repentance and remediation, where there is a possibility for gradual upgradation, where there is a possibility for universal brotherhood, affinity, where there is a possibility for commensurate embrace of God. Because we are also monotheistic in our religion. They are also monotheistic. But the difference is, we are rationally monotheistic and they are radically monotheistic. That is, radical monotheism is rational monotheism. See, God has created innumerable species. He cannot compel all people to talk a single language, to take a single food. Likewise, without making the person suitable to a divine model, compelling everybody without description or without discrimination or status analysis to worship a single God is idiocy and lunaticism. they cannot be compatible with that. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, O Arjuna, I am the Supreme, I have installed different modes of worship as per the trimodal modular structure or configuration of people, Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa, goodness, passion and ignorance. On the basis of these three modes, I have installed religions, deities, worship model based on the geospecific gravity of their land, mind setup of their people, the philosophy of their livelihood behind that, the based on the food, the thought, association. So considering various other socio-demographic, religiographic, philographic positions of their land, I have designed different religions for them. So Arjuna, any person worshipping that religion, that sturdity, that conviction, that staunchness I am installing in them, gradually he finishes that, exhausting the status, he gradually approaches me and attains my abode. This is what we call rational monotheism. There is only one God, but depending upon the variation that exists in the receptivity of innumerable workers, instead of compelling them to worship a single God, God has designed different worship modes according to their status and slowly upgrades them to reach him. That is the greatness of our culture. That is known as rational monotheism. This is what we call the greatness of our land. And God has created only these things. It is known as five organs. One is form, and second, if there is a form, there must be a system of worship. If there is a system, there must be a center of worship. If there is a center, there must be a rule of worship. If there is a rule to monitor that, there must be a team. So, having a form, having a system, having a center, rule and team, everything is made by God. But the team is organized by human hacking. That is where all the corruption, all the contamination started. God assumed different forms. That is told in Shastras. Ajayamava Bhagutha Vijayate. He assumes different forms for our emancipation. He only created various systems of worship. Pancharatra and various agamas, they have been instructed only by him. Even Shilpa Shastra and Nirmana, everything was initiated by him, by his divine mercy, to great architects like Maya, Vishwakarma and Kashyapa. The rules of worship are also modified by him. So everything he has done and handed over to human beings, when human beings started doing that in human handling, it has created in domination and suppression, malpractices, fraudulence and various other activities started. So we have to think and we have to revive this thing. That's what I used to say in one lecture I quoted. God handled demons like Prahlada and Vibhishana. When great demons like Prahlada and Vibhishana are handled by God himself, they become better than the celestials and worshipable. When humans handle the same God, God handled the demons and made him even more godly. When the same God is handled by humans, he will be worse than a demon. It will be a warehouse of all mistakes, errors, sins, offenses and crimes. That's what we are seeing now because of human handling. See, who is affected? Number one, the public is affected. If your temple is mismanaged, the public is affected. So we have to get public supervision and vigilance. Second, those who are managing the temple, they are affected. Their progeny is affected. They have to go for supervision. The government is affected. Famine, flood, drought, natural disasters, lot of clashes, disharmony, everything comes out of mismanagement of divinity, the Shastra said. So they have to, government, they have to make for supervision. And we have to create a model, which I call it as a KWS model, knowledge, worship and service model. Our temples are just abodes of nonsense and nuisance. Everywhere shouting, no mantras are there. Everywhere except a temple you can get peace. That is the position today. So there must be knowledge. Whenever you insect, see, what is the greatness behind the Islam, how they are integrated, because they are taught and trained properly. They are trained properly. The purpose may be different, I don't know. But they are taught and trained properly. So it should have a center for knowledge. Then after knowledge, they have to go to worship. Because knowledgeless worship is very, very simple and silly. After the worship, they should mature into service, making himself serviceable for others and service to others. So it is known as KWS model. At least we have to build a temple or take over a temple to do all of these things. Coming to the conclusive session, I want to say what are the positive hopes that we are having for the development of India Century Mission. Countries like Israel and Japan, you are seeing. Japan, after a very great Holocaust, still it is surviving and it has developed a lot. Because of the immigrated commitment and patriotic, productive patriotic or applied patriotic vigor of the citizens of the country. And Israel is also like that. It is good in administration. It is well established and administered in spite of all its alliances and other forces. holistic forces, hostile forces. Everywhere unanimously deciding to destroy Israel. Still they are developing because of their integrity. But India, in spite of disasters, in spite of political instability, border insecurity, internal insecurity, social evils and struggles, still it is surviving without even integrity, only because of the greatness of the people whose footprints are there in this land, not because of your area for commitments. Because we have seen developed countries developing because of visible patriotism and productive integrity, which we are not seeing here. So if we are developing by an unseen factor guidance. I don't know how long it will continue, how far we are going to make it continue. That is our role. We have to do that. That is the first thing. Second thing, they have mentioned about yoga. Yoga is very much essential. You see, what is the use of yoga? Yoga is useful for five major things which we call as Panchashakti. How to freeze, face and facilitate hurdles. There are three powers with hurdles. In problem mechanics, they say how to freeze hurdles. I cannot freeze it. Then how to face hurdles. More than that, how to facilitate hurdles, how to convert, how to manual your skill by hurdles themselves. So it is like waste recycling or waste productivity management, which we are calling now. So it is waste recycling, like it is a process by which the crisis is recycled into comfort. So that power is only in yoga. But now what we are practicing is not that yoga. Making some asana, just I called some people and asked them to demonstrate some yoga asanas. You know, yoga seminar. They demonstrate like this. Then I asked them, you are just giving the postures of a parrot, a rabbit, a bow and various other living and non-living things. If just for remaining 5 or 6 minutes in the portion, if you want to get some benefit or if you believe that you will get the benefit, then that particular element is in that posture throughout its life. Marjanasana is the posture of a cat. You are putting the Marjanasana only for 2 or 3 minutes. But the Marjanasana cat is in that asana for throughout its life. It has to get more benefits. Unless it is culminated with Yama and Niyama, the principles of obedience in life, unless it is mixed with Dhyana, Dharana, the purpose or goal of life, then the postures make no difference between natural postures of those animals or those structures like bow. So yoga is practical yoga, no doubt asanas are the beginning. So we can face hurdles, facilitate and freeze hurdles. That is, if we can maintain relations, how to forgive people, how to adjust with people, how to transform people. So there are three different areas and we are mismanaging. Wherever we have to forgive, we are struggling. Wherever we have to struggle, we are forgiving. So where to forgive, where to adjust. If somebody's son is drinking, how we can forgive or how we can adjust? We have to transform. So mind has three powers. One is to transform others to their own level, to adjust if we are having some problems, or to control whenever it is required for somebody to be controlled. So it has the power to transform, it has the power to influence people and to bring something whenever adjustment or whenever tolerance or whenever some sort of achievement is impossible or unworthy. So that power is also there. Boosting of intellect. Whenever we take a book and read, or whenever you do something, it is rejoiceable. It is known as Jnanananda. But everybody is quarreling. Everybody, they are conducting battles with their books, with their masters, with their school and infrastructure. It is because of lack of proper management skills for intellect. So that is possible only for yoga. So by yoga, we can have self-counseling, counseling others, and distant counseling at all. So whatever that we are seeing, the UN high-level threat panel, it has given 10 major alerts or alarms to the world, amongst which 5 things are like inter-civil wars, then mass atrocities, then border clashes and conflicts, war, then internal communal harmony, disharmony, and various other things. So 5 of that high-level threat panel's suggestion is to do with mismanagement of human mind. So whenever there is a small hatredness, it blossoms into conflict, then becomes a war, creating a genocide. So this type of mind control is possible only by yoga. So we have to practice this yoga. Third thing I want to say, it is a very, very important vital factor. One should have a strong belief and practice in his own system. But that strong belief and practice is not there. I was invited to one inter-religious harmony function. Then they asked me very directly, you are wearing a symbol of a particular religion. How you can work for inter-religious harmony? Then I told that only a pregnant lady or a delivered lady can understand the pain of the labor and the pressure of progeny. Only a person having a strong power or a substantial will in a structured religion, he can understand the root of a religion, and root of his brotherhood religions and the reasons to be united, everything, only a person who is systematized can understand that. So a person who is just like a medley, medley means a person who is in different numbers of religions, he cannot work. A skeptic who does not believe any religion, he cannot be a good ambassador. And a peripheral who knows just the apparent status of all religions, he cannot work. Only a person who has known a religion can understand the pain of religious disharmony and pressure of united religions initiating. So we have to follow that. Now we are confused by three things. One is unanimity, second is equanimity, third thing is unanimity. That is, it is known as a pseudo-compromise. Now everybody is saying all religions are equal. All religions are equal, that means that all religions, they should be equally respected and they should gain equal status in the society and work for the common development. So claiming this type of pseudo-compromises in the society by equanimity, that is Samyavada, anonymity, all these religions we have made and God is different from this, that is anonymity. Synonymity, you need not work any God, your honesty, your truthfulness and your sincerity itself is God. So if you say, if you segregate God from your practical life and thinking that this itself is God, that is inanimity, God is different from all religions which you practice is inanimity, all are telling the same thing is equanimity. These things have diluted the spiritual courage and heritage glory of our land. Everybody, they are not wearing tilak. Simply they say that great Maharishis, they have contemplated inside the mind. Are we a Maharishi? They just say that everything should be in the mind. God loves in only our mind and all are equal. All of these great philosophies, they are misinterpreted and misconceived by people, accusing their sluggardishness and deviation. They are fostering and nourishing the people's sluggardishness, nations and evasion. So, we should be proud of our heritage, and at least on the festive occasions or divine occasions, we should wear the dress and show our unity and our integrity. That should be there, it is not there. Then final point is, what is the use of Indian civilization now? It has two uses. One is the salient model, second is the special model. Two forces have been envisioned by our great seers, ancestors. One is a developmental factor, second is a balancing factor. The whole world that is contemplating or concentrating or considerably developing only development factors. When these developments are not there, how to live? That is known as abhava sannidhi, absence. When these things are not there, absent, how to survive? One. Number two, if they are with us, how to properly use? Number two. Three, when we are growing there is a possibility of a coercive, circumstantial, unintentional or intentional slippery. Whenever a person is developing, there is a possibility for slippery. How to avoid that and how to be balanced? India developed the model for balancing. Contentment model, renunciation model, mind determination model, self-determination model, conviction model, universal brotherhood model. So these various types of model that makes a person to be free from imbalances. If I am more powerful, I want to destroy other people. Or I want to develop myself. It comes either in self-centrism or destroying others or ill-treating others because of lack of proper balancing of his mental equilibrium. So our Vedic tradition, they were the first, even before the development, they have initiated a balancing. That's what I told in Delhi seminar also. For us, Dharma is the breastfeed of our mother and all the Artha and Kama, they are the hand feed. Whereas the Westerners, they are otherwise are reciprocated. So we were born with balancing knowledge. Then only we started understanding our development so that we are very clear, so that we are very balanced, so that we are well protected and we can show the way for others also. It is known as a balancing. That balancing is starting only from our land. So how to develop these balancing systems, that requires a workshop which we will discuss later. And coming to the final point, number one, what we have to do now, how to start this thing now from this day, anyhow we want to start from this day. We have to start something connected with, as we know that we cannot complete these things in 1 hour or 2 hours of session, there should be one academic environment where we can teach people. That should be an exclusive school model. By whatever we are having now is just imitation. That's what I told in one seminar, that India should first become, must be brought back to Indian style. Somebody asked me what to do with Indian knowledge for best. I told that first India should be brought back to Indian style, then we can bring the Indian style to everybody. Because India is not an Indian style. In the pretext of Indianship or in the pretext of Indian development, everything is Western. What are the things are adoption and imitation of the West? Some scientists told that India has produced a lot of scientists. I am not telling about the rishis or the great people. There are four types of intelligences. One is innovative, second is creative, third thing is imitative, fourth thing is operative. Most of our skills are imitative and operative. We require a lot of things to be filled in the first two models, creative and innovative models. Anyway, most of the things we are imitating, most of the things we are adopting, and we are westernized, and something is roaring inside to be Eastern. So we want to be first Indian. Then we can make everybody Indian. So we want first a training institute whereby we can teach students. Number two, we want to produce some sort of residential complexes or townships where we can have some sort of serenity to develop a model of worship behavior and survival at home. Third thing, we have to make training for teachers, training for parents also, because domestic and academic environment, they play a major role. We have to train the youth and entrepreneurs. We have to develop this, I am working on. We have to develop special training skills. Rishi Prabhakar, today you might have heard about Rishi Prabhakar. We have discussed in bringing 6 students to our ashram at Hyderabad, that within 6 months, they will be well trained in 5-year syllabus of MBBS or BTEC. Without any spiritual indoctrination or any coercive indoctrination, they will be doing like that. So it is a specific training. He's talking about media, we are having politics, we are having journalism, we are having science and technology, we are having industries. All these people are away from us. There is an article written in a magazine, which is also published recently by Pragya Bharati, in which he is very much associated. There they published how many media industries are there. They have been managed by anti-Hindus. They are purchased by anti-Hindus. Most of the journalism institutes are produced by people, those who are in communalism, those who are in anti-Hinduism, those who are having skepticism and rationalism, the so-called atheism. One is the atheistic people, the communist people, or the anti-Hindu people, they are owning the media industry. Either directly or indirectly, they are having international network and international worldwide fund structure by which they can manipulate, they can manage, they can purchase, and they can man any person and any number of things. Unless we have our representatives, specially trained people, they must be journalists. We need 5 components in the society, in the political society, in the knowledgeable scientific community, in the media industry, in the judiciary industry, amongst the youth representative. Unless we develop these 5 people, it may take 10 or 20 years, 2 or 3 decades, even let it take. What is the problem? It is a corrosion of various centuries. Why can't it be renovated in 1 or 2 decades? We can wait for that. And NSR, I think that he will also be extended to live and see and experience those things. So this is the practical way by which we have to bring these things. So I told in one seminar of history that history must be taught not as a story. History must be taught in such a way, such a turbulent and torrential way, that it penetrates into the veins of the person to make him to remember of his own glory, wherein by it creates a zeal which is a driving force for awakening his conscience and consciousness to actively work, productively, committedly work for the reinstallation of the heritage. So that is the history. Teaching history for the reinstallation of the heritage. So that is the history. Teaching history as a somnolent lullaby is also possible by most of the teachers. But awakening the society is also the same history. Somebody asked me, what will you think when you read about your heritage? I told that I will have 3 feelings. The first is pride that I am belonging to that heritage. Second thing is pity that it is in such a deplorable condition. Third thing is shame that I have not sufficiently worked for it. So this is what we should have in our minds. And we are expecting 2 things. There are only 2 possibilities. One, a mega negative force should trample on the society so that they will get some awakening. Or a mega positive force should be landing on the society. Maybe they will get that enlightenment. Either that awakening or enlightenment, a mega positive or negative, it will be immediately landed on this earth, landed on this holy earth, which is known as Karma Bhumi. That's why I told in one seminar that just as we are having thorium content and also uranium deposit, we have water facilities in one part of the earth and another part of the land we don't have. So in minerals, in various other essentialities like the gems, like various gold and other things, we see mines in particular places and we don't see them in the other parts of the place. Likewise, India is the birthplace of civilization. India is the birthplace of divinity. India is the Karma Bhumi. It is the birthplace of universal knowledge, love and eternity. So it is naturally given by that. So India, by its widened arms, it has to invite and embrace all the other people. That is the duty, that is India's century mission. Moreover, we have conducted innumerable seminars, and whatever we are sounding, whether people, listeners, they are becoming carriers and conductors to the society or not, God is hearing and He is vigilantly observing our sincere efforts. Only on that belief, I hope that it will happen soon. Narayan, Narayan.
If power comes in our man, then he will use up in three ways. Like one can destroy the world, one can improve his development, and one can use for our society. Then his mental position is not balancing of that power, then how can he balance, or how can he come in equilibrium stage to handle this power?
It is known as lesha prapti. If somebody is speaking in an auditorium about something, there is a small spark. It is a sample. It should make you, it should drive you, if you are really interested, sincerely interested, that should intervene in your routine habit to meet such persons to discuss more. That is known as anuvartana, or it is known as anusmriti. Whatever you hear from me today, you have to rethink it several times. That is anusmriti. You have to follow me or people like me and hear several times. This lesha prapti will lead you to shastra prapti. You can go inside shastras. If you read more shastras, more books, you can get a little bit of clarification, which will make you to understand about a guru and reach. If you understand the guru, he will take you to the pathway of solution. So whatever, you cannot get everything from a single lecture. And what you want is a product of a sincere practice of several years. How to control your mind and how to be happy? It is a very simple question, and I can also answer in two or three different models. But this thing is totally useless, because it is a way of life. It is an art of life. The only problem in the society, which I want to say, is somebody asked me why we have been invaded and what is the reason for our destruction. Simply, I will put it in two or three sentences. At first, there was Vidya Parampara, whereby great yogis, they practiced spiritual methodologies and were very powerful. That is known as Vidya Parampara, or Year of Vidyas. They practiced really with penance and austerity, and they were very powerful. Then gradually they degraded and they kept the Shastra Parampara. They were just making a lot of quarrels and debates about this came first or that came first, egg came from that hen or hen came from that. These type of various other unwanted dry, these debates are done by the Shastra Parampara, and that was totally polluted and diluted. Then came the mild Kala Parampara, where people were interested in architecture, art, then various other forms like dance and other things. They have become very mild and soft, easily malleable and fragile for any invasion. So the Vidya Parampara has lost, and Shastra Parampara came, which was just in words. Now then it has transformed into Kala Parampara, where people were very much in aesthetic sense and gratifications. Now it is in Bhasha Parampara, just we are talking about everything. So we have to come back to Shastra Parampara. If you want to get your mind in control, it is a practice of 10 years. But we should start it from today.